Alright, so when I got an invite from Ameya, and when she told me that the summit would be called Key Makers, I asked her one thing and one thing alone. I said, so these keys that you're trying to make, you know, where are the locks? She said, what do you mean? I said, key makers, and when I was growing up in Hyderabad, I went to a school called St. George's Grammar in Abbots. And when I used to walk on the footpath of Abbots, we used to have all these chabi banane wale, key makers, you know, right? So I asked her, are you talking about those key makers? Are you talking about something else? She said, no, sir. We are going to solve the problems of the world. We are going to come out with some unique solutions. We are going to throw up challenges. We are actually going to have a lot of young people congregate, come together, think about what are the challenges that we face as young people, and we will try and come out with some rock solid solutions that will have a huge societal impact. So I'm delighted, honored to be here. My apologies for showing up late because I was stuck somewhere else, but I'm delighted to be here. Haven't done this in a while after elections. In fact, I'm not part of the state cabinet anymore, so I have not had an opportunity to interact with many of you off late. But let me tell you, these are exciting times. These are very exciting times. This is an exciting time to be a young person in India. Never before in our history was a better time to be young. This is the best times to be young. In fact, like I mentioned, so much to look forward, so much to dream, so much to aspire for, and so much to achieve. There is a sense of optimism across India today, which is all pervasive. Today's youngsters in India are not bogged down by the baggage of our past. You guys have no memory of the infamous 1950s and 1960s low growth rates. You have no memory of the times when we used to get only one single channel on television, where in fact growing up as a kid, I used to watch Chitrahar and all that. I don't know if any of you even know about Chitrahar or know single channel television sets anymore, but that was the time we grew up in. You have no such baggage. You have no such memories. You have no memory of long waiting periods of months and years to get a telephone connection at home, or those long queues which we saw so often to even get a train ticket or to get onto a train, to hop onto a train. You have, like I said, no memory of any famines or epidemics hitting our towns and villages where thousands of people have lost their lives. This was all a thing of the past. The present India today is a transformed place. It is a place which is transforming really, really quickly and really, really rapidly. It is a place where we hope for things to get better every day. Like Sri Charan put it, one step at a time, making sure your family is taken care of, making sure your vicinity is taken care of, making sure your neighborhood is taken care of, and thereby making sure our towns, our cities, our villages, our state, and eventually by extension, our country is taken care of. It is a place, the current India, where we hope for things to get better every day in technology, in infrastructure, in employment, in economy, and also, more importantly, in equal opportunity. We can see this growth with our own eyes. Right now, India, according to numbers, according to statistics, is growing at 6.5% or more. It is now the sixth largest economy in the world. Its per capita income, India's per capita income, is growing at about 5.5% a year. And good news is, India's large population. I remember a time when I was growing up, when I was in school. Now, we had this association called FPAI, the Family Planning Association of India, which used to do massive campaigns, which used to run massive publicity campaigns, wanting to make sure that India controls its population explosion. But good news is, India's large population is not a matter of concern anymore. Our population is now stabilized. It is growing at 1.2%, much lower than what it was two decades ago. In fact, India now has so many young people that this is now called the demographic dividend. Just to give you a sense of what I'm saying. If you look at India today, 1.32 billion people, more than 50% of India is less than the age of 27. More than 65% of India is less than the age of 35. So imagine the kind of opportunity, the kind of optimism, the kind of entrepreneurial spirit that can really take India to the next level, provided we all aspire and we all collectively put our intellect together. At one point of time, India's population was considered to be a bane. But now, like I pointed out, this demographic dividend, this young India today, in a knowledge economy, can be called, it's a huge blessing and a boon for the entire country and also by extension for the entire world. Population dividend, in popular parlance, is nothing but young people coming together, is nothing but large demographic dividend that I talked about, is nothing but all of you coming together, putting your collective intellect to make sure you come out with solutions for popular good and for societal benefit. We cannot help but notice that the youth of this generation are a brave lot. I was just hearing, I just had the opportunity to hear Sri Charan speak for the first time. The most impressive thing about that speech, the most impressive thing about how he presented Stumax to you was fearlessness. There was no fear. You know, they say public speaking, in fact, according to a survey, it's not me saying this, public speaking is apparently, you know, the most dreaded thing in the world, even more dreaded than death itself. But what I really liked about his speech was that he was fearless. He had no fear. In fact, one piece of advice, because many of you, I'm sure, while you want to create employment, while you want to create more jobs by being entrepreneurs, some of you may also end up being job seekers. The one biggest thing that is going to help you in achieving your goals, achieving your dreams, is being fearless. When you go for an interview, ye maan ke chalo, ye maan ke interview table pe pahunch jao, interview room mein pahunch jao, ki agar mujhe naukri nahi milti hai, to uska loss hai, mera loss kuch nahi hai. It is that person who's going to interview me, who's going to be at the receiving end, who's going to actually, you know, lose out by not hiring me. That's exactly what he was pointing out. You know, when he said, please send a text to somebody if you want to intern, saying, if you don't hire me, you're going to lose out. That should be the spirit. Because when you walk in with that kind of mindset, that you have nothing to lose, that you have nothing to fear, then the real you comes out. The conversation that you have to yourself, that you normally have with yourself, that will come to the fore. That will enable you. That will help you in being fearless, in communicating extremely, extremely potently. The future of India, and I'm sure you've heard this many, many times in the past, the future of India is most definitely in your hands. One of the founding fathers of the United States of America, Thomas Jefferson, he said, apparently, he believed that each generation looks at itself as a distinct nation. If we go by what he believed, with so many young people in our country in India, we are looking at a completely different and transformed India. It is a new India altogether. There is a great sense of optimism, yes. There is, you know, like I said, you know, this generation doesn't hold itself back. My young son, you know, who's 13, you know, he is, I mean, when I was growing up, I can relate to that age and, you know, that at that time. When I was 13 or 14, if I had to speak to my father, I would be extremely, you know, I wouldn't say I would be, you know, I would be scared, but I would definitely think twice and be very circumspect before saying anything or before uttering anything that might, you know, not be very respectful. But today, my young son who's 13 doesn't think twice, you know, doesn't hold back when it comes to sharing his feelings, when it comes to sharing, saying something directly to my face, whether or not that is something that I would like or not, he wouldn't think twice. Now, I would say our youth is far more literate today than any previous generation, and more importantly, the economy is also growing rapidly as you grow, you know, not older, but as you grow grow in your careers as well. But the fact is, we still have many challenges. And our Chief Minister, our Honorable Chief Minister, Shri K. Chandrasekhar Rao Garu, you know, when I was a part of his team as a Minister for Information Technology, he always used to ask me one thing. He said, you know, whenever we went to him with new solutions, whenever we started talking about T-Hub or startups or, you know, anything that is fancy in terms of technology, he used to ask one question pointedly. He used to say, will this actually have a positive impact on the society? Will this solve a problem that I currently face in my day-to-day life as a common citizen? If the answer is no, then you might as well, you know, rethink about how, you know, you would come out with your next solution or next entrepreneurial idea. Fact is, India as a country today has n number of challenges. For those of you who are looking for entrepreneurial ideas, for wanting to do something which is going to not just benefit you, but also the country, you might want to start looking around. For instance, when I became a minister in the initial days, when we were sitting together as a team, we said, okay, what can we do using technology to solve the problems of a common man? You know, I'm sure many of you here have your own motorbikes and you ride them to college and back home and to a lot of other places as well, right? When you typically ride a bike or, you know, drive a car, you know, police, a traffic cop will stop you once in a while and will basically check for all the papers that you're supposed to carry, a registration card, an insurance paper, and of course your driver's license. So in initial days, when we assumed office, when the new state of Telangana came into being, we said, how can we solve this problem? So we threw this challenge at one of our young startups here, who worked up and said, I might come out with a solution. The startup was called Radical Tribe, and they came out with a solution. They came out with a digital wallet, and we called it M-Wallet, a mobile wallet. The Road Transport Authority immediately liked it. So along with the traffic police, along with the transport authorities, this young startup came out with a solution. So as long as you had a smartphone, you could have all these three pieces of document, all stored electronically on your phone. So whenever a traffic cop stopped you next time, all you had to do was flash your phone. And if he had a reader which could scan through, then immediately you were off. So these are the small, ingenious, small, you know, interventions which will make your startup idea an extremely successful one. Let me tell you, this application, this app has been downloaded, the RTA M-Wallet has been downloaded more than 20 lakh times already. So that goes to show you the power of the small utility which can help, you know, ease the pain point of a common citizen and at the same time give a huge fillip to your entrepreneurial idea. See, today's youngsters, all of you, you're not content in only being a job seeker like the generations before. You're not content in securing a government job for life. You're not content in actually staying in a job for very long. You know, we used to have lifers. You know, whenever I meet some people who say, I've spent 30 years in, you know, government service, or 30 years in Mahindra and Mahindra, or, you know, 25 years in Ashok Leland. And when I share that experience with some young people like you, you're surprised. You don't understand how somebody can stick on to same organization and same job for so many years in one go. I don't know if any of you in this room are going to stay in one job for next 30 years. I don't think any of you actually will stay in a job for more than, you know, 2 or 3 years. So that's the kind of generation we live in. That's the kind of times we live in. There are, Sri Charan just pointed out, there are, you know, the Zuckerbergs, there are Steve Jobs of the world. Let me tell you one thing, and let me admit to this unabashedly also, without thinking twice. I've lived in the United States for about 8 years. I've lived in many other countries also for some time. World over today, Indians as a nation, Indians as intellectual people are acknowledged, are accepted. The world understands that we have great problem-solving abilities. The world acknowledges that we are fantastic when it comes to analytical skills. The world acknowledges a lot of things about us. That's why you have a Sundar Pichai running Google. You have a Satya running Microsoft. You have many, many others. Ajay Banga running the MasterCard. I can go on. There are many, many people who are either chief executives or the managing directors or fantastic, you know, people who are running large multinationals. But unfortunately, at the same time, the world does not think very much of Indians when it comes to entrepreneurial capabilities. So if you look around, you have a Zuckerberg, who I don't think he's even completed his graduation. You also have many, many other entrepreneurs who may not have done a great deal. In fact, Travis Kalanick, you know, the guy who founded Uber. Many of you use Uber. How many of you use Uber here? Oh, many of you. And how many of you use Ola? Equally, good. See, Travis was here. Travis Kalanick is the founder of Uber. He was here in Hyderabad to launch something. So I asked him, I said, how did you come up with this idea of Uber? You know, he said, you know, me and my friend back in 2009, we were in Paris one day. We went out clubbing. We went out to a pub. And, you know, we were out until 2 a.m. in the morning. And then eventually, we all decided to head home. We walked out. And we kept hailing for a cab. It just, you know, nobody would stop. Almost half an hour later, the friend who was standing next to me said, you know, wouldn't it be nice if you could hail a cab at a click of a button? That was a trigger. That was a trigger for the whole idea of Uber, and today it is the world's largest, world's wealthiest startup, Uber. It's one of the largest in the world. Point I'm trying to make is, you know, these are, it's not like you have to come out with an earth-shattering invention. No. Look around. Be receptive to ideas. Be receptive to challenges. Once you start looking around, once you start identifying opportunities, then you'll realize that in every challenge, there is a hidden opportunity. In every problem that you see right in front of you, staring at you, there is an opportunity for you to innovate. There is an opportunity for you to disrupt. And let me also say this, and this might not sound very good, but nevertheless, you need not be original all the time. You could even be, see, for example, there is an Amazon, but then there is a Flipkart, there is a Snapdeal, there is a Myntra. The model is the same. But they've customized it, they've tweaked it a bit to suit our Indian mindset, to suit our Indian needs and Indian conditions. So you need not be original all the time. It's all about giving that one little tweak, one little spin on how that can be customized to our needs and to our situations. Now, let me also quickly say one thing, and I think this is what has been said by somebody very, very important, I'm sure somebody who you all look up to. Spider-Man. What did he say? With great power comes? Wow, you know Spider-Man like I don't anyways. But at the same time, you cannot be reckless. You cannot be irresponsible. Meaning, I'm not trying to preach. I'm not trying to give you a lesson in morality. But I can just tell you, you cannot disinherit your culture, your language, your stories, or your history. Your English speaking skills is not something that will make you a successful entrepreneur. Your ability to be ingenious when it comes to identifying an opportunity is what is going to make the difference. But for that to happen, you know, you need to be grounded. You need to be connected to the world that you live in. You cannot be isolated. Now let me quickly sum up. Even in Telangana, in the state, like Charan pointed out, we created T-Hub, which again is a platform for you to come and innovate. It's not just a building, it's not just cool interiors. It is a platform for you to come, collaborate, to network, to basically mingle with other youngsters who are looking to do something and innovate. The other thing we've also done, which we are extremely proud of, is called RICH, the Research and Innovation Circle of Hyderabad. It is also equally important since we are in Ambedkar Open University, since we also have a lot of researchers working at this university, and also a number of other wonderful institutions across Hyderabad. It is also important for us to realize a lot of academic research that happens in our universities, that happens in our centers of excellence, unfortunately, is not worth commercialization. Now, this is something of a challenge which we need to address as well, because if you look at the world, if you look at the Stanfords, Harvards, MITs, and other wonderful universities of the world, you realize that many, many entrepreneurs, in fact, have come out of these universities from their research, from the billions of dollars that they spend on research. Unfortunately, in India, while we do not have luxury of, we do not have a problem of luxury of ideas, we do have a problem of poverty of capital, you know. So therefore, we may not as governments be able to give our universities great deal of funding when it comes to research and development, but we certainly can collaborate with the private sector. That's why we came out with an idea called RICH. Now, RICH is basically about all about bringing in collaboration between industry, academia, and the private sector as well, so that this continuum of wanting to encourage more and more innovation, wanting to create more and more products and more entrepreneurial ideas, which will have a large societal impact, also, you know, gets a huge fillip. For those job seekers, for those of you who want to be a job seeker, for those of you who'd rather be a job seeker, we've also created what is called as TASK, Telangana Academy for Skill and Knowledge. Now again, this is more like a finishing school where you can walk in and basically spruce up and hone your communication skills and other skills as well. We have also established TSIC, the Telangana State Innovation Cell. This again can help you. If you have an idea, if you have some kind of an innovation, you can work cohesively with other like-minded innovators and come out with something, especially when it comes to rural innovators or social innovators. We would strongly encourage, I would strongly encourage you to work with TSIC, the Telangana State Innovation Cell, which again is headed by a gentleman called Fanindra Sama, who is the founder of Red Bus. He's a guy from Nizamabad, you know, a youngster from Nizamabad who went to Bangalore, who was working like Sri Charan in Wipro, or I think it was Kakatiya Sandbox, of course. But prior to that, he was actually working at Wipro in Bangalore. And then he chanced upon this idea. He, again, same thing, like Travis, he wanted to book a bus to his hometown, Nizamabad. But implicit, he wanted to book a bus to his hometown, Nizamabad. Unfortunately, he did not find a great solution online. So he created what is called as redbus.com or .in, I think it is. And now today, it is again valued quite handsomely, and he's made a good exit as well. So he's heading our TSIC, Telangana State Innovation Cell. These are stories you can draw inspiration from all around you. These are day-to-day problems, day-to-day people who've actually found something, who chanced upon something, created an ingenious solution, and that's how today they are able to build, you know, talk about a story that they've built, which is hugely successful, hugely recognized. I also want to talk about two last things and then I'll quit. We've also launched, for young women here in this room, we've also launched in this very campus, in fact, I think it must be right next door, what is called as V-Hub, Women Entrepreneurs Hub. So if you're keen on working with other women entrepreneurs, other women, other young women, again, this is an opportunity. We can connect you to them as well. We also are going to launch what is called as T-Works. Now, T-Works will ensure that an innovator can translate his idea into a prototype. For those of you who are not on the technology side or not on the software side and who want to actually build something, you know, a prototype, etc., into hardware, you can use T-Works, which will also be up and running, I think, in about in a few months from now. Finally, I would just sum up with one thing. You know, it's a cliche now to keep reminding all of you that India as a country is a young country and you are our strength, etc., etc. But the time, I believe, has come for youngsters in India now to step up to the challenge. Because so far along, India has only been known as a country which is a back office for the rest of the world. If you watch a Hollywood movie or if you watch even a Netflix you know, series, you'd realize that, you know, there is a lot of, I wouldn't call it a smear really, but I would definitely say a lot of stereotyping out there, you know, where people believe that India is essentially a call center for the rest of the world. Now, do we want to continue to live with the stigma, continue to live with the smear? I don't think so. We are more capable than that, especially you guys. You know, you guys are more capable than that. So my request, I urge you, I appeal to you that you should start looking out a bit more often around the society that we live in. You should start looking at the day-to-day situations that you face and possibly start exploring it as an opportunity. Look at every challenge, treat it as an opportunity. Like Sri Charan pointed out, yes, you will fail. It's not like you're going to hit the, you're going to strike gold the very first idea that you'll chance upon. But start celebrating your failure as well. It's not always about, you know, celebrating successes. Start celebrating your failure. Start working on a solution tenaciously. Start coming out, you know, start going at a problem, you know, as hard as you can. And if you pursue with a single-minded focus and devotion, nothing will stop an idea whose time has come. Many congratulations to Ameya. Many congratulations to all the participants. I wish you all good luck, and I wish the key makers session here a huge success. Thank you very much.